Hello, everybody. My name is Alvin Law, and I am so thrilled to be here today. 40 years. Oh, my God. What a celebration. And I got to tell you, I am, yes, one of the eternal optimists that are out there annoying everybody with how very fortunate I feel to have no arms. I said it, and I mean it. And you know what's interesting is when people see me, their first impression of me is, oh, that's so terrible. Look, there's another one of those crippled people, those disabled people, those handicapped people. You can feel the negativity oozing out of so many people. But you know what's fascinating? If I sit down and I put a pair of drumsticks between my toes and I do this, then the impression changes, doesn't it? Let me grab a chair and let's just chat for a minute before we go on with this very special program to celebrate 40 years of parasport in Ontario. And in fact, celebrating parasport, period. I'm not an athlete, although one could suggest I'd be great at the game of soccer. Yeah, I know, I never get the penalty for touching the ball with my hands. Cool. But I was also not ever expected to do what you just saw. You see, the problem that I see that happens too much in society, and for the next little while, we're going to address this discrepancy, is why is disability a bad thing? I was born without arms in 1960. And when people say, look what you overcame, yeah, I did overcome having no arms from birth. But what I overcame was the stigma, was the label. You know, my label was very specific, thalidomide baby. That's a big word. And if you don't know what that is, then you don't know. But if you've heard it, you're going, yeah, I remember those deformed children from the 60s. Yeah, it was a morning sickness medication that caused my lack of arms. But even more important, I was also homeless at 5 days of age. This is not meant for pity. This is not meant for sympathy. The way we see the world is dictated by what we have learned. And yes, there's problems. And yes, there's challenges. But the good news in my story, and this is not about me today, but I'm so very, very honored to be here talking to you right now, is I was adopted. And the culture in my home was the opposite of the prevailing culture of the time. Instead of a curse, I was seen as a blessing. Instead of impossible, the expression in our home was there's no such word as can't. But we did not in 1960 have the vehicle or the outlet or the opportunity that was introduced 40 years ago when parasport became real. Now in 2021, we recognize the heroes. We recognize the abilities. We recognize the tremendous talent that so many of our athletes exhibit worldwide. And Team Canada means something. That's worth celebrating. So that's what today is for. To not mourn what we don't have or what we're missing, but to truly celebrate what we do. Because it is a celebration. We've come a long way, baby. And there's no way we're gonna go backwards. It's forwards. And the impossible, yes, it truly is possible. If you don't believe it, watch this show and you'll change your mind.
Thank you and welcome to The Power Within. And thank you, Alvin, for a great kickoff to this very special event. Welcome to everyone who has joined us tonight from across the province and across the country for this special hour of celebration. We're celebrating excellence tonight with special guests like Alvin, special awards, and incredible people who have brought the parasport movement as we know it today to this point. We're doing that tonight by celebrating 5 decades of parasport in Ontario with the official launch right here tonight of ParaSport Ontario's new commemorative publication entitled The Power of ParaSport. The people you'll meet are exceptional individuals, many of whom are featured in the book, people who have not only revolutionized sport for athletes with a disability in Ontario and beyond, but for new generations that have followed. My own professional and volunteer career has been largely centered on making sure people get the support they need to get the most out of life. That's what ParaSport Ontario does, and I'm so pleased to be a part of that as the chair of our board of directors. ParaSport Ontario is all about connecting the disability community to opportunities and with equipment to ensure that everyone can find a sport or activity that's right for them. We truly believe there is indeed a sport for every body. So let's begin the celebration, a celebration of the power within us all to overcome obstacles to inclusion and participation. And to tell you more, I'm pleased to introduce three-time Paralympian, world record holder, and the publisher of The Power of ParaSport, ParaSport Ontario's own executive director, Jeff Thiessen. Jeff?
Thanks, Bob. And good evening, everyone. So glad you joined us tonight. I want to tell you a little bit about ParaSport Ontario's new book. So let me start this way. A pioneer's path is rarely a straight one, and usually settlers prosper in a land far from those first trails. And so is the case with the ParaSport movement in Ontario. You know, how possibly could our visionaries have imagined what they first voiced and sculpted would look like today? And through all the change, one thing remained constant: our athletes and their passion for ParaSport. The fabric and the cornerstones of the movement, always blazing a better way for those coming up behind them. And that's what our new book, The Power of ParaSport, is all about: celebrating visionaries, pioneers, milestones, and athletes from five decades in Ontario. And personally, I've seen these five decades of ParaSport firsthand, from the 1970s to today, as an athlete, a journalist, a publisher, and now executive director of ParaSport Ontario. For me, it all started with a strange looking hockey stick that my dad made for me after I lost both hands when I was 11. And I still believe today that that adapted piece of equipment really paved the path, paved my way to the podium at three Paralympic Games. So it's with tremendous pleasure and an honor to celebrate other pioneering heroes like my dad in the book and celebrate their stories. We believe, really believe wholeheartedly, that this legacy publication will educate and motivate and inspire others to lead and compete and advocate. A big thank you to the Ministry of Heritage, Tourism, Sport and Culture, and our family of corporate sponsors for supporting it. Tonight, you'll meet some remarkable individuals from the book, some incredible guests, and even more exceptionality in our award winners. I hope you'll enjoy what we have to share tonight.
Like any journey, ParaSport Ontario's began with the first step, and our first steps were taken in the late 70s. It was a new time for sport for the physically handicapped. For a long time already, the medical profession knew about the great value of physical exercise in treating disability. Awkward and inappropriate sentiments by today's standards, for sure. Far from how para-athletes are characterized today. But those were our first steps in a five-decade passage that brought us to here. And to see how far the ParaSport movement has come in Ontario is to know where it began. Change came swiftly, and pretty dramatically too. No one even saw it coming, actually. It arrived in Ontario with two hops and a swing of an artificial leg in the sweltering summer of 1980. Terry Fox is now an icon. Back in 1980, he was just a kid trying to save the world from cancer. But he was even more than that. He was a visionary, and what he did for ParaSport movement can't be overstated. Remember, there was no social media at the time, no likes, no smiling emojis to cheer him on. Just a curly-haired runner agonizing along the Trans-Canada Highway on a prosthetic leg. Those images changed what Canadians thought they knew about athletes with disabilities. Fox had been a minor blip on the nation's radar until he entered Ontario. until he stormed Ottawa to meet Prime Minister Pierre Trudeau, who knew nothing about the run, and before Fox headed into Southern Ontario. He was running with 1,000 goals in his head each day. Just get past that sign, get past that big tree, get past that school, he told McLean's writer Ken McQueen, who shares some of that story in our Power of ParaSport book. We all know that Terry's dream ended just east of Thunder Bay, after more than 5,000 kilometers traveled and the job half done. But in his own words, a prophetic message to ParaSport visionaries and pioneers to follow. Even if I don't finish, Fox predicted, we need others to continue. It's got to keep going on without me. And it did. It said that without Fox's inspiration, Rick Hansen's Around the World Man in Motion tour might not have happened. So many other great visionaries in the book, including Hansen and Vim Kochhar, whose dream for a cross-country torch run to raise awareness for Canada's Paralympians and the abilities of all people with disabilities became a reality in the form of the Why Not Marathon in 1996. And Joe Millage and Archie Allison, who together at Variety Village reversed the course of integrated sport to flip the script and get kids without disabilities to want to join wheelchair sport for the fun of it. Like the proverbial pebble in the pond, the ripple effect of their vision created inclusion groundswell in Ontario and way beyond. And of course, the incomparable Jeff Adams, who like Fox did, transformed the scope of the word athlete in the eyes of Canadians. So, before we welcome five-time Paralympian and six-time world champion Jeff Adams, and three-time Paralympian and CBC broadcaster Rob Snook to join us, here's a look at a slice of Jeff's impact through his McDonald's TV commercial.
When you live on a farm, you don't raise your kids by coddling them. You teach them to stand up for themselves. But when your boy gets sick and loses the use of his legs, what's your philosophy then? Well, I'll tell you when I first knew. When my boy said, Dad, cut off these brakes. I want to go faster. I just never realized he meant faster than everyone else in the world.
At McDonald's, we share the belief that anything's possible when you have a dream.
Hey Jeff, I want to take you to back to the beginning of your time in sport. When you think about a kid growing up in Ontario, what was your path from, you know, playing road hockey with your brother on the road to competing in your first event, and how did that happen? What was that process?
I mean, it was pretty organic. You know, I was always very involved in sports. I played, like you just mentioned, you know, hockey and baseball and tennis and swam and played basketball and did all these things with my brothers and friends when I was growing up. And then, you know, was injured when I was 9 years old as a result of complications from cancer treatment. And so, like a lot of people who become disabled, I was pushed into sports and was given an opportunity to try a bunch of them. Found that, you know, I tried racing and tried swimming and tried a bunch of these different things, and I was just very naturally talented at racing. And I really enjoyed the individuality of the sport. I love team sports, but I liked it to be like totally responsible for the winner, for the loss, and just to have that sort of level of independence. And so I sort of fell naturally into racing.
A lot of us who are involved have opinions about this. The question I get asked a lot is, don't you think that the Paralympics and the Olympics should be combined in one event? What do you think?
I mean, first, logistically, it's just unrealistic because you can't you know, the Olympics are so unwieldy, both events are so unwieldy already, that to combine them would just be overwhelming. I'm a big fan of the Paralympics, and I've talked to a lot of volunteers who, you know, participate in both the Olympics and the Paralympics, and almost, you know, uniformly, they'll tell you that they would rather volunteer if they had to pick one of the events, they'd pick the Paralympics because it's a better, more exciting event. And I just look at the sort of the stories that come out of both movements or both events. And, you know, the Olympic stories that we remember are the ones that have to do with people. They're not necessarily stories about sports. They're stories about people who get injured and overcome it, or, you know, have some kind of moment that they have to overcome. And, you know, when you're at the Paralympics, like, I just look around and it's like, there's 4,000 of those, like every single Paralympian has that story. And so, you know, the opportunity to have these deep, you know, moving experiences, I think happens more often at the Paralympics. So from that point of view, I just think they're a really interesting event, and they provide an opportunity that goes beyond just sport in a way that the Olympics don't.
I think it took probably both of us a long time to learn that, but I agree. I also think that we learned how to become ambassadors. We learned how to become ambassadors for Canada when we went to the Paralympics, and then we learned how to be ambassadors for the Paralympics and for people with disabilities when we came back home again. Does that resonate with you?
Yeah, I think so. And you know, it's I think the Paralympics does a lot of favors to sort of society in general. But one of the things that I noticed when I was in London is how openly people were talking about disability. And I think that was part of that was because the media was making a conscious effort to address disability in a very responsible way, and in a way that spoke about the disability, but in the context of sport. And so instead of doing, you know, these motivational pieces about disability and things like that, they would talk about disability in a very matter-of-fact way and how it affected the performance of the sport. And I think that was the motivational stories are great, and I think they need to be told, but it was just this, they upped it a level by talking about disability in an honest and matter-of-fact way. And that was something that I had to learn how to do as well, to acknowledge my disability. And like you said, I mean, you know, you can be an ambassador for the Paralympics, but you have to have the ability to be honest about disability to do that. And so that was sort of my progressive journey, is to try to be as good of an ambassador as I could be, but then to achieve a level of honesty to the best of my ability too.
Six-time Paralympian, six-time World Championship gold medalist, 13-time Paralympic medalist, three of them gold, Jeff Adams. Thanks for doing this, Jeff.
Good to be here.
Every year, ParaSport Ontario presents our family of awards to exceptional individuals in a variety of fields. Tonight's first presentation is the Dr. Robert W. Jackson Award, celebrating a lifelong commitment to volunteerism. That was Dr. Jackson. An orthopedic surgeon, a pioneer of pioneers in disabled sports in our country, and known to many as the father of the Paralympic movement in Canada. Here to present the award in her father's name is Johannah Jackson.
This award means so much to me, my family, and I know to my father, the late Dr. Robert W. Jackson. I remember just how honored he was to have an award in his name. He was the first recipient of the award. In fact, it was one of the last awards that he ever received while living, and we were there to celebrate with him. The winner of the 2020 Dr. Robert W. Jackson Award is a world leader in the development of sport for athletes with disabilities. Alan Dean led the ParaSport movement as a founding member of the Ontario and Canadian Amputee Sports Associations, and as a technical advisor for the 1976 Toronto Olympiad. It was my father that introduced Alan, an amputee and an elite parasport competitor himself, to the possibilities of adaptive sport. And for four decades, Alan has played a monumental role in the growth of parasport in Canada and all around the world. Alan Dean, it is my honor on behalf of my family to present you with the Dr. Robert W. Jackson Award. We know our father would be very pleased that you are receiving his award. For your long work and dedicated work in the growth of parasport in Canada and all around the world. We wish you the best in your future endeavors. My family is so pleased to present Alan Dean with ParaSport Ontario's Dr. Robert W. Jackson Award.
I am very honored to receive the Dr. Robert Jackson Award. It is a significant award to me. I knew Dr. Jackson extremely well. He was the person that got me involved in sport for people with disabilities when I attended a physiotherapist seminar in 1976. And following that, I registered to participate in the Ontario Games for the Physically Disabled. From then on, it was just, everything was just amazing. I got involved as an athlete and then got involved in the administration. But Dr. Jackson was always a mentor for me, and when taking my placement at Durham College in sports admin, I worked for Dr. Jackson at his clinic, his sports medicine clinic in Toronto. So it's been an exciting ride for me. I've really enjoyed it. I'm really, really happy to receive this award. It is a significant award to me. It means an awful lot. Thank you very much.
Congratulations, Alan. Alan Dean, a true pioneer. So let's talk pioneers, the second of four sections in our new book. Parasport pioneers, where to begin? Ontario was full of them and still is, for that matter. Our parasport trailblazers did things and made things that just didn't exist. And not so much in boardrooms, but on poolside bleachers and trackside benches, in small town barrooms and Holiday Inn bedrooms where they'd meet after regional and provincial games that brought them together. No internet, remember? And if you took a front row 40-year bleacher seat at Variety Village in Scarborough, you might have met most of them. There's no question that the path of our parasport movement went right through the front doors of Variety Village, the world-renowned training and fitness center. Pioneer stories from the village are endless, but one of my favorites goes back to 1983. Variety Village had just hosted the world's first fully integrated track event that featured Canadian Olympians like Angela Bailey and Ben Johnson, and the world's best wheelchair racers. TV coverage was great from Global and Sportsline. But here's what's most remarkable. In the days after, Variety Village got a phone call from the Los Angeles Olympic Organizing Committee. They wanted to know how to go about finding the world's best to race in a wheelchair event at the 84 Olympic Games, and how wheelchair sport works. History was made, and a wheelchair event was part of the Olympic Games for decades. So many pioneers, and we've captured a lot of their stories in The Power of Parasport. Like senior Sarah Thompson, who started her powerlifting career at age 60 and became a world champion. Coaches Ken Hall, Ken Tom, Faye Blackwood, Steve Bialowis, Anthony Clegg, Peter Erickson, and Amanda Fader, just to name a few. And not because what they did, but how they did it. Windsor's Celia Southward, who created the Windsor Classic Indoor Games, the largest indoor adaptive sport event in North America. Kevin Humphrey, who has pushed power hockey in Ontario for more than a quarter century. And Elizabeth Walker Young, Paralympian and chef de mission, who carries the torch for women in sport. And there's Jess Silver, who's doing the heavy lifting to make fitness facilities more inclusive. And of course, the incredible phys ed teacher John Howe from the W. Ross McDonald School, who created so many opportunities for blind and visually impaired students, and Paralympians for that matter, who competed against Brantford area high school kids. And in the spirit of where we began, Joe Ross, a passionate wheelchair rugby player, the founder of the Toronto Bulldogs Wheelchair Sports Club and ParaSport Ontario's first executive director. Our pioneers, from what they fostered, us settlers have certainly prospered.
Our second award of the night, presented to three remarkable individuals, is the Bob Secord Award. The Bob Secord Award celebrates in others the same ideals and invaluable contributions that Mr. Sport made to Parasport that impacted so many others. And to present the awards this evening, I am honored to welcome the Honorable Lisa McLeod, Minister of Heritage, Sport, Tourism, Culture, Industries. Minister McLeod.
Hi, I'm Lisa McLeod, Ontario's Minister for Heritage, Sport, Tourism, and Culture Industries, and I'm so proud to be here today to be part of The Power Within and launch of a remarkable book, The Power of ParaSport, celebrating five decades in Ontario. I often say as the Minister of Tourism that we are the world in one province, but what I love about our Paralympians is they showcase Ontario to the rest of the world. This publication is going to introduce you to a number of remarkable individuals who have revolutionized sport for athletes with a disability, including Martha Gustafson, Ontario's most decorated Paralympian of all time, and Jeff Adams, a six-time Paralympian and world champion in wheelchair racing, and so many others. Sport has the power to bring everyone together and everybody. While we may not be able to celebrate as we normally would due to COVID-19, I want to commend everyone here today for continuing to persevere despite these trying times. I look forward to cheering you all on at the Paralympics and at a variety of different other events that we host in Ontario in a post-COVID-19 world. I'll also continue to support important areas in our city and our province, like Variety Village. So to all of those who are award recipients tonight, congratulations. And to all of you who participate, thank you so much. And for the first Bob Secord Award, Martha Sandoval Gustafson is Ontario's most decorated Paralympian. Working as a secretary in her native country of Mexico, she never envisioned that coming across a group of people playing wheelchair basketball would change her destiny. Martha won 12 medals for New Mexico at the 1976 and 1980 Paralympic Games. In 1981, Martha moved to Canada and began training at Variety Village in Scarborough. Competing for Canada at the 1984 and 1988 Paralympics on the track and field events, swimming and table tennis, she brought her Paralympic medal count to 19. Martha continues to be active in trans and parasport today, curling and playing wheelchair rugby. A tremendous ambassador for Parasport Ontario and role model for others, I'm pleased to present the Bob Secord Award to Martha Sandoval Gustafson.
For some people, you know, they ask me when I'm going to stop the games, my sport, and I say, well, until I move a muscle. That's when I want to stop. I don't really want to stop. I want to thank to my parents, especially, and my children, all my family and friends for their love and support over the years. Also, I want to thank Barb Montemuro, who passed away last month. She was a very supporting person in sports and para sports, helping people like me and other athletes.
Thank to my coach, Ken Hall, for being very supportive since 2005 until now. He's supporting me in athletics like drawing, shot put, discus, and javelin.
Thanks to my coach, Paul Zbiranowski, of rugby wheelchair, and to Alex Sinclair and my swimming competitions, and to Steve Baila in track. He is now basketball para athlete. There's so many changes in this sport over my sport career, like classifications. Each sport has different equipment to do competitions and is more competitive now than 15 years ago. I want to mention that when I start practice sports in Canada, I find Variety Village. I met Joe Millish, that he also supported me several years, and so many people that I can remember for now. I can remember names. There's so many people. Thank you.
Our second Bob Secord Award goes to a dynamic duo, husband and wife team Reg McClellan and Chantel Benoit, who together changed the sport of wheelchair basketball in Canada forever. Chantel competed in the most ever Paralympic Games by a Canadian wheelchair basketball athlete with 7 appearances. She was leading scorer during the team's dynasty years, which included 3 Paralympic gold medals from 1992 to 2000. She's been coined the Michael Jordan of women's wheelchair basketball and is maybe the greatest player to have ever played the women's game. Now, Reg, he spent 20 years on the national basketball team with a resume comprising 6 world championship appearances and 4 Paralympic Games. He founded the Canadian Wheelchair Basketball Association in 1994. Their wheelchair company, 49 Bespoke, is all about giving others a chance to play too. It's all about teamwork for this tandem. And it's my pleasure to present Chantel Benoit and Reg McClellan, the Bob Secord Award.
Thank you, Mr. McLeod and ParaSport Ontario, for this super recognition with the Bob Secord Award. To be honored in the name of Mr. Sports and Recreation Ontario is humbling and give us an opportunity to reflect on all the developments there has been in amateur sports in Ontario and beyond.
From Mr. Secord, we see commitment. He had 4+ decades in developing sport and recreation programs in Western Ontario, directing community programs, starting of the Ontario Games, becoming Assistant Deputy Minister of Sport and Recreation in Ontario, and being inducted into Canada's Sports Hall of Fame. It was a fitting tribute that he became an honorary life member of Sports Ontario and the Canadian Olympic Association and other recreation societies. That is an honor.
Reg and I grew up in sport. I was involved in every sport that came my way, excelling in hockey and diving. Reg was the same, playing fastball, football, volleyball, and especially hockey, covering all seasons. We got together 30+ years ago in wheelchair basketball. Reg represented Canada for 20 years on the men's national team, and I enjoyed 28 years on the women's national teams. So naturally, we were both involved in that sport, in the global sports community at every level, as a player, organizer, volunteers, administrators, and every other position needed, really, including being taxi drivers for teammates when needed.
Highlights for us relate to the annual municipal team schedules, provincial games, national games, the Paralympics, and the World Championships. We started to play wheelchair basketball in folding day chairs and worked with companies to develop different products, companies that were able to engineer equipment that was made to measure. Today, we enjoy being involved in promoting sport and rec for all, including able-bodied players at every level. That creates a great opportunity for awareness, inclusion, and socialization.
Yeah, we may not be thinking technical, tactical, physical, or mental every time out in our local game today, but knowing that the physical aspect is great for all of us and the social commitment component of it is second to none, we are meeting needs that are universal to all of us.
Thank you very much for the recognition.
Merci beaucoup.
Congratulations, Martha, Chantel, and Reg. Many milestones among them. And that's where they are found in the Power of Parasport book, in the milestones part. We built the third section of the book around superlatives, dates and numbers, firsts, farthests, and fastest, milestones. Like the number 3 for amputee Carlos Costa, when on his third attempt he became the first person with a disability to swim across Lake Ontario. 51 kilometers, 32 hours. Joanne Bao, now Joanne Berdan, one of Canada's most influential athletes ever, and her double-triple, 3 Paralympic golds in discus, shot put, and javelin in Barcelona in 1992, and 3 more in Atlanta in 1996. 75,000, the number of spectators flocking to the 2017 Invictus Games in Toronto, Prince Harry's most successful games to that point. 2012, the year wheelchair racer Josh Cassidy, whose idol Jeff Adams inspired him to take to the track, recorded the world's fastest time ever at the Boston Marathon. And how about Rob Buren's bragging rights? Rob is the first Canadian wheelchair user ever to complete Hawaii's grueling Ironman triathlon, cranking his hand cycle 180 kilometers, pushing his racing chair another 42, and swimming 4 more. And then there's simply just being the greatest. Fergus Ontario's Patrick Anderson is just that, considered to be the best wheelchair basketball player the sport has ever known. And the same goes for our Bob Secord Award winner, Chantel, who played in 7 Paralympic Games, sharing that Canadian record with teammate Tracy Ferguson, who together won 3 successive Paralympic gold medals and went 10 years in international competition without losing a single game. And that still stands as one of the most extraordinary winning streaks in the history of sports. But among the best in all of these milestones for me is the story of Toronto couple Clarence and Julie Merrigan. Knowing them is to know that dedication to a sport is not the domain of Paralympic athletes alone. 3 times a week, year after year after year, Clarence and Julie have risen at 4 a.m. to catch their wheel trans ride to Variety Village. To work out in the gym or on the court, or swim, or lift weights, or play bocce. And when I say year after year after year, Clarence began in 1978. At the Ontario Games for physically disabled. They both have ribbons and medals to show for it, but that's not what it's all about for them. It's not about the desire to win. It's about being able to play. It's about life. Like Clarence says, find something you enjoy and do it. And as Julie adds, teach others and help them to learn how to enjoy life too. Unsung heroes. They are hard to measure with numbers and dates and distances, but they are very important mile markers along Ontario's Parasport Movement Roadside 2.
Tonight's next award is the Justin Hines Say What You Will Award. Inspired by Justin's Say What You Will hit single that was met with worldwide acclaim, the Justin Hines Award celebrates individuals who exemplify advocacy for others, speaking up to support and promote the abilities of athletes with disabilities, and using their voice to encourage opportunities in sport and recreation for others. To present the award in his name is the internationally renowned singer-songwriter, recording artist, and advocate, Justin Hines.
Hey everybody, it's Justin Hines, and listen, I can't tell you enough how much of an honor it is to have an award named after something you contributed to. But, as we all know, it takes the efforts of many to make the world a little bit of a better place. So with that in mind, I want to congratulate Amanda Fader on being this year's Say What You Will Award recipient. Amanda, your efforts towards inclusion are nothing short of inspiring, and we are so grateful for everything you've done. So on behalf of myself, ParaSport, and all the lives you've impacted, Congratulations on your award.
And how could I show you? Say what you will.
I am honored to be presented with the Justin Hines Award to be celebrated as an advocate in parasport. There are hundreds of incredible people that deserve this more than I do, but I humbly accept on behalf of them all. I've been extremely fortunate to have had the opportunity to build a career in sport where work is play is work, and it doesn't get much better. I love my work, I'm committed to it. We have a responsibility to ensure that everybody has the opportunity to play and has a meaningful experience. Where they choose to take it is their call. Recreation, high performance, multiple sports, a single sport. I'll support whatever, however I can. And I'll be very thankful to have been part of their journey. There are so many incredible humans who have impacted me, but without Bob and Kathy Schrader, forget it. They welcomed and encouraged me from the minute I stepped through the door. I'm very grateful to my gang at OCPSA, and thank you for believing in me. And to every athlete that I've ever worked with, thank you for the trust. It's been truly an honor to have been a part of your lives. I'm in awe of you amazing people. I'm constantly impressed by your energy. I strive to convey the same enthusiasm. Being with like-minded, passionate people motivates me to raise my vibration. It's I who thank you for the opportunity to be a part of your lives.
The games, the last, and of course not the least section in the Power of Parasport. In this part, we let the incredible photography we found from the last 5 decades tell the story. And we're going to do exactly that here tonight, too. But just a quick backdrop. There were 3 games over our 5 decades that had the most impact on parasport in Ontario. First, the Toronto Olympiad for the Physically Disabled in 1976, following Montreal's Olympics. These games are now known as the first Paralympic Games in North America, and really set the stage for regional and provincial games for Ontario's athletes with physical disabilities. And what went on behind the scenes at the Toronto Olympiad is equally compelling, with political drama and wrangling not only from our federal government, but others as well, mostly surrounding human rights issues and money, of course. The province's high watermark for the Ontario Games for the Physically Disabled, as they used to be called, came in 1987 in North York, the Mel Lastman Games. And they may still be the best ever. Public and media attention was amazing as Mel's personality pitched the games front and center. A visit by Prince Andrew and Sarah Ferguson, the Duke and Duchess of York, didn't hurt either. And Mrs. Lastman threw a gaudy going for gold gala that raised over $250,000. Competitions were top notch and plenty of volunteers made it even more memorable. And in 2015, Toronto hosted the Para-Pan American Games, which brought parasport to new levels on many fronts. Huge ticket sales, millions of social media impressions every day, and lots of CBC TV coverage. And of course, its legacy of awareness, new opportunities, and accessible venues. The biggest and best Para-Pan AM Games ever. Games are about the athletes. And now, a tribute to our athletes, 5 decades of them, from participants to Paralympians. And to help us do that, I am thrilled to welcome contemporary and jazz performing artist, singer-songwriter Simone Saman, who recorded I Believe, especially for us in this moment tonight. Simone Saman.
There comes a moment when my heart must stand alone. On this lonely path I've chosen, like a house that's not a home. Sometimes when I feel I've had enough, and I feel like giving up, you will need to be all I can be. Now nothing can stop me. I believe in the power that comes from a world brought together as one. I believe together we'll fly. I believe in the power of you and I. This is the moment we have dreamed of all our lives. We'll be the change we wish from others. We'll stand tall for what is right. And in my heart there'll be no doubt. The arms of the world will come reaching out and embrace me to be all I can be. Now nothing can stop. I believe in the power of you and I. I believe in the power of you and I. I believe in you.
Congratulations to ParaSport Ontario for 5 decades and the release of a new book, The Power of ParaSport. WorkBay is thrilled to present tonight's live stream. The ParaSport Ontario Athletes of the Year, our longest standing awards, are selected as much for their outstanding efforts in their sport as for their contributions to their sport and others who participate with them. The 2020 Female Athlete of the Year goes to Jolin Wong. Jolin is a member of Canada's women's sitting volleyball team, a team member for 13 years, competing at 2 World Championships, 3 Para Pan American Games, and the 2021 Paralympic Games will be her second. To promote her sport, she is presented at the Volleyball Canada Coaching Symposium to an international assembly of elite coaches. And she's a fixture at ParaSport Ontario Professional Development Days. Jolin Wong.
Thank you so much for awarding me the ParaSport Ontario Female Athlete of the Year. I have so many people that I'm grateful for getting me this far. First off, I couldn't have achieved this without the patience of my small children. They are constantly waiting for me to finish my training and traveling with me to all my events. And my husband for supporting me and allowing me to chase this crazy dream. I'd also like to thank all my coaches and staff from near and far. I have local coaches here and coaches all the way out in Alberta for the countless hours that they've put in to develop me as an athlete and as a person. And a little history about my journey this far in ParaSport. When I first acquired my amputation, which was a long time ago, 18 years ago, I think, I had no idea ParaSport was a thing. I grew up in a small town, didn't know anyone with a disability. And then when I was playing volleyball in high school, my coaches contacted Volleyball Canada. And from there, we found that sitting volleyball was just starting in Canada, so 13 years ago. And I've been with the national team program ever since. I have a really great passion for just spreading the awareness of parasport. I think it stems from not knowing about it when I first acquired my disability. And I just don't want anyone else to feel that feeling of not having other people on a level playing field, I guess you could say, and always trying to keep up with the able-bodied athletes. So yeah, I just love spreading the awareness and encouraging others to try parasport. So thank you again for awarding me this.
The Male Athlete of the Year award recipient is Chris Garner. Chris is a multi-sport athlete competing at the provincial level in para ice hockey, para golf, and sitting volleyball. He's working to grow his sport in the Niagara region, he coaches soccer, and has just launched an amputee support association in Niagara as well. Chris Garner.
Wow, thank you so very much for this recognition. This was something that was definitely not on my radar for 2020. I have a lot of people that I definitely want to thank really quickly here, so I'm going to get to that real quick here. I need to thank my mother, Judy, my children, Brennan, Jaden, and Kayla, my father, Andy, with the Falls View Hose Brigade, Kelsey and Wesley, a couple of really good friends of mine, my coach, Paul, and Margie Rylette with the Thunderblades, Jeff Tissian at ParaSport Ontario, Todd Kierstead with Team TK, John White at Rock Golf, the Niagara Penguins Association, and everyone who's been such a really big part of everything. And it's been an amazing journey this year.
And our Junior Athlete of the Year award goes to Nico Iema. Nico Ironman Iema is an elementary school student with a remarkable drive and passion for sport that led him to create the Bocce Busters program for athletes in the Durham region. Like many parents, Nico's didn't know where to start in sports for their son with special needs, but Nico did after he saw the sport of bocce on TV. Nico and his dad Patrick continue to strive for excellence and realize that their path to success calls for creating opportunities for others. We are proud to present our 2020 Junior Athlete of the Year award to Nico Iema.
Parasport is a chance for kids like me to play and to be able to play in a sport that no one else can. Parasport is a good opportunity for me to be able to interact with other kids and people with disabilities. I think that parasport has really changed me for the better, and it's just a great opportunity for all kids with disabilities to play in the sport. Thank you so much for this award. I'm honored that you have chosen me as a recipient of this award. Having cerebral palsy is a daily struggle, and playing sports like other people my age isn't always easy for me. But bocce has given me a sport that I cannot just participate in, but be really good at. It has given me confidence, and it has allowed me to dream big. I am honored to be given this Junior Athlete of the Year award. It's amazing. So thank you very much. And thanks to my dad for being my assistant, and to all those who play with me and have taught me the game along the way.
Our next presentation is the Community Impact Award. This award could easily be called the Unsung Hero Trophy. It's for individuals who give quietly, but make a loud impact on those who benefit from their generosity of time and effort and passion for parasport. Last year's recipient, Rocky LaFranco, is instrumental in the success of ParaSport Ontario's annual Para-Pro-Am golf tournament. And so is this year's winner. For the past 3 years, the Food Dudes, led by founder Derek Wasser, have provided a culinary experience on the course and in the clubhouse for our golfers like no other. Their gift to ParaSport Ontario. And when just 3 days before our event last year, the Food Dudes were awarded the entire food contract for the NHL playoff bubble in Toronto. What did Derek say to us? Don't worry, we'll still be there for you. Let me introduce to you the 2020 Community Impact Award winner, the Food Dudes, and Derek Wasser.
Well, first off, I want to thank Joe and ParaSport for the tremendous honor for the Ontario Community Impact Award. It means a tremendous amount to myself personally and my entire company at Food Dudes. I want to say that on behalf of my team, in the past when we've represented ParaSport from a food and beverage standpoint, it's been a highlight of the year for many of my team members to be able to go to the golf tournament and to see all the tremendous work that ParaSport does and to help support your cause in any way possible. We look forward to supporting ParaSport in the future always. And we really thank you so much for the award today. And I can't thank Bernie and Bertie Gluckstein enough for introducing me to this beautiful, beautiful cause. We really appreciate it. Thank you.
And for our final award presentation tonight, a very special one for us too, ParaSport Ontario's Ambassador of the Year Award. Our team of ambassadors is one of our greatest assets. On the courts, in gyms, or out on the fields, our ambassadors are impacting young participants and athletes in ways we never could without them, always with the belief that there is a sport for every body. And leading the way is Aristotle Domingo, a multi-sport athlete himself, an advocate, a peer mentor. Aristotle knows firsthand how to find a way to play. From sitting volleyball to paragolf to track and field, his example, purpose, and passion for ParaSport has changed the lives of countless others. We are very pleased to present our 2020 Ambassador of the Year Award to Aristotle Domingo.
In 2017, I had my left below knee amputation. And then, as soon as I had my surgery, it was like a sigh of relief. And people always find that funny that I said, I was waiting for that to happen. I wanted it to happen because it was literally like releasing a ball and chain. You know, it was a rebirth, if you will, a refresh of life. And then I rediscovered my active lifestyle. I started running, and Sunnybrook runs with this story, that I did my first 5K 5 months after my amputation. So I had my amputation in January, and I ran my first 5K on a temporary check socket. May of 2017. And I just meant to do it for myself. It wasn't anything that I wanted to, be a hero for anything or any attention that I've gotten really out of it, but it's just something that I wanted to get back to. And I started, you catch the bug, if you will, as they say, and I started running a 5K every month since then. And then in 2019, which was expected that because of my activities that I was getting into, that I would also lose my left leg for the exact same reason. And so again, osteomyelitis developed on my left leg, and they said, well, what do you want to do now? Knowing the experience I had with my left and knowing the possibilities what I could have with also not having so much issues on my right, I opted to have my right below knee amputations. Whether or not, it turned out exactly the same way, because it doesn't, it never does. I can still participate in the active lifestyle that I'm just doing them differently now, right? So again, it wasn't that, if this doesn't work out, my active lifestyle is gone. In fact, I was equipped to not even have both legs working again. I already have a sports wheelchair that I use. I have all the equipment that I need to do what I need to do. And so just discovering all those things by being involved with ParaSports opened a wide range of activities for me to get it to be a part of. I'm extremely honored to be receiving the Athlete Ambassador of the Year Award for 2020. I'm very grateful for the recognition that I've received for my work with ParaSport Ontario. I want to thank Joe and Jeff Thiessen for all their support, and looking forward to the next couple of years. And as Jeff said, there is a sport for everybody. So thank you.
Hello everyone, my name is Marissa Papa Constantino, and I'm so excited to be here for the Power Within event. Being a part of para athletics for about 9 years now, I can't express how much sport has really changed and opened up my world to so many opportunities. Being a ParaSport Ontario ambassador has really allowed me to share my experience with others and to help motivate and encourage the next generation and our youth to really get involved in sport and inspire them to get involved, because I know firsthand how much it's made an impact in my life. So having had said that, I want to introduce you guys to our future stars. Meet Molly. She's her skating club's first sledge skater. Seeing the joy on Molly's face is what it is all about, says Pina Gilmore, the president of Skate Canada. It's all about letting kids like Molly know that yes, they're equal. Skating on a sledge is still skating. Pina went on to say that other kids on the ice look up to Molly, and the high fives they share prove it all. Meet Suni. Suni started playing basketball in 2016 after a friend introduced him to the sport. His mom, Samia, said, "I'm looking to get Suni involved in a sport to boost his confidence and for him to socialize." ParaSport Ontario and generous donors of the fund made that possible with a new sports wheelchair for Suni. And his mom reported, "Little did I know, it would turn into such an important part of his life." And finally, meet Chris, the latest recipient of our Play to Podium fund. Chris received a running leg from ParaSport Ontario with the help from Osir Canada and Prosthetic Energy. Chris uses his prosthetic leg for running, swimming, jet skiing, and working out. And he has a sight set on the snowboard course at the 2022 Paralympic Games in Beijing, China. ParaSport Ontario supports all members of the disability community to help them find their activity or sport of choice. And that can also include their equipment needs. So if one might want to play basketball, they'd require a basketball chair. If one wanted to play sledge hockey, they'd need a sled. If you wanted to race around a track, you'd need a racing chair, or in my case, a running leg. That's exactly what ParaSport Ontario's Play to Podium provides for all of their future stars. I really hope you all enjoyed the experience and maybe learned something new today. I also hope that you enjoyed meeting our future rising stars of ParaSport in Ontario. I know that I was inspired by their stories, and I hope that you are all inspired by them as well. I think that this event really shows how there really is a sport for everybody and everybody, and how important it is to push for diversity, equity, and inclusion in our sporting environments. I want to wish everybody positive vibes in these really tough times and to stay safe and healthy. Take care.
Thank you very much, Marissa. We really appreciate you talking about our Play to Podium fund that I want to talk just a little bit more about. But just to share with everybody, about a year ago, I got a chance to interview Marissa. It was around this time, and a really uncertain time for our Paralympic athletes, and a lot of stress and anxiety. And Marissa talked about, you know, when the games were ultimately postponed, it was more of a relief than a disappointment. And I didn't quite understand what she meant, but she said, you know, we didn't have the opportunities to train, and we didn't have the competitions to qualify. The venues were closed, and we just have questioned how could we be our best. And that's not something that a Paralympic athlete is comfortable with, that's for sure. So Marissa, thanks for sharing that. And that's in our ParaSport magazine, a really poignant interview with Marissa, very honest and raw about life as a Paralympian in these strange times, for sure. But to talk a little bit about a little bit more about what Marissa was talking about in our Play to Podium fund, like she said, that, you know, whether you're playing recreationally or competing on the international stage, adaptive equipment is really an important part of it for a lot of athletes. And that's where our Play to Podium Fund comes in. It's to help athletes and participants that need that $5,000 sports chair to compete and to play, or that $7,500 hand cycle to participate with their family and friends in that activity, or a $1,000 sled to get back on the ice. So we, meaning ParaSport Ontario, launch each season a $50,000 campaign to get people back in the game in their
own equipment, and our winter campaign is doing really well. We're just $12,000 short of our goal right now, and we certainly always welcome the help to get us to the finish line. So if interested, please visit our website, and all you need to do is click donate. And for those that are looking for a sport or an activity that's just right for you, give us a call. Email us or go through our website. We certainly want to connect you with one of our many partners like On Para Network or Ontario Cerebral Palsy Sports Association, Ontario Blind Sports Association, to name a few. So give us a call and we will be sure to get you on your parasport pathway. What an exciting night. I was really torn, and unfortunately I've seen a few pieces of this that were pre-recorded before. I was torn between the great comments in the chat section and what we were seeing on our screen. And well, it was nice to see a lot of people reconnecting tonight, that's for sure. Nico, your whole class is watching, that's for sure. Jeff Adams, you got a great comment from Scott Lewis. Excellent words, a life-giving message. And so many more people that remember other athletes, remember games that they were at. It was really cool to watch. So, yeah, thanks for contributing that way. We've got a great closing segment for you tonight. Two, actually. We want to play you out with Justin Hines' acclaimed music video, Courage, which is perfect for these times. And then you'll hear from our friend Alvin Law one more time, and he'll give you a quick message about where you can purchase your copy of Power of ParaSport, if so interested. So before I say goodnight, certainly a heartfelt thank you to our many book sponsors, our event sponsors, those being Move, Hollister, Ontario Power Generation, 49 Bespoke, Sunrise Medical, the Rotary Club of Whitby, the Orange Lounge, and of course, Workbed. You met James a little bit earlier, who donated their services to put this production together, and donated James, their incredible creative director, to produce what you saw tonight. So thank you all for sure. Same goes as for a heartfelt thanks to our idea man, executive producer of tonight's program, Joe Millage, and our hardworking ParaSport Ontario team of Ellie Speck, Emily Blackborough, Melissa Drake, Star Hansen, and Barbara Moore. And of course, to our exceptional lineup of special guests who generously donated their time and their talents to what you saw tonight in the event. So we'll get together in the chat after you hear from Alvin and he signs us off. And thank you to all of you, our guests, who joined us tonight and made this a really special night for us in our book launch and just a celebration of our community, for sure. So we hope the message was clear, that there is a sport for every body, with the emphasis on capital B-O-D-Y. And off to Justin. Enjoy. A tribute to everyone involved, pioneers, visionaries, those that set milestones, and of course our athletes with courage. Good night.
Dark tonight, wanna touch the starlight when I go. And if I know the feeling's right, well, then I found my place to go. Wanna face the dark tonight, wanna tell him I am on the rise. Love no longer out of sight, silver linings in my eyes. I said, courage, won't you come out to play?
I know the feeling's right. The cause of freedom's here to stay. Gonna ride alone tonight. They will know the battle's all been won. Faith no longer out of sight. My heart pointing to the sun. Yeah, I said courage. Won't you come out to play? Come out to play. I've been living it down again, but I'ma bring it back someday. I said courage. Won't you come out to play? Come out to play. I've been living it down again. I'm gonna need to call your friends. So here's the hope that I find you along the way. Yeah. And if I take it all for granted, I can throw it all the way. You come out to play, you come out to play. I'm living it down again, but I'm bringing it back someday. Say courage. Won't you come out to play, come out to play. I'm living it down again. Well, I'm bringing it back someday. Say courage. Won't you come out.
Oh, wow. I even need one of these, man. What an emotional event this has been. And you got to understand something. We have been talking about so many positives. Let's not lie. All of us with a disability have had our negatives. We've had our challenges. We've had our low and dark moments. But I am here to suggest that this celebration today is absolutely what the most important element represents. And that is just being ourselves. But more than anything, what are you going to do now? First, you're going to go get a copy of this wonderful book, right? Because you need to have one. But second of all, what's your plan now? Especially during these strange times we're in. I believe that our energy dictates our outcomes. So when we think we can't, we're probably going to figure that one out. But at the end of the day, there is always so much. There's an old jazz song that endings are new beginnings, right? We've ended an era in our history where disability was not only disrespected, but it was absolutely something that we could not imagine the value. Well, guess what? There's value all around us. All we gotta do is look and find. Look and find. Thanks for joining us today. And remember, we all count.